nein.
I like your yellow and black.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, good morning. Sorry. I'm a little behind schedule. I'm trying to get back to the swing of things. I know you all missed me last week. So, naturally, we got to run through the announcements. First, Monday, February 13th, 6:30 p.m., board meeting. Next week, Sunday, February 19th, is Family and Friends Sunday. Bring everyone. My understanding is that Muskegon Pregnancy Services will be here. You have in your bulletin a list of things that they would love to have, and you can provide for them. We also are going to eat next week, and all you have to do is bring dessert. Okay, I got a few oohs and ahs, but everybody else is like, oh, really? I wanted to bring roast beef. Come on. We're having spaghetti? All right, it's a spaghetti dinner, and you bring the dessert. So, that being said, I believe that's all the announcements. Did I get that right, Mom?
You did great.
That's awesome. She thought she was going to have to make that one. Hey, thank you. Thank you so much. All right, that being said, walk across the aisle, tell somebody you love them, and say hello. At the entrance is a description of how the store operates. You may visit this store only once. There are 6 floors, and the value of the products increase as the shopper ascends the flights. The shopper may choose any item from a particular floor or may choose to go up to the next floor, but you cannot come back down except to exit the building. So a woman goes to the husband's store to find a husband. On the first floor, the sign reads, Floor 1. These men have jobs. She's intrigued, but continues to the second floor, where the sign reads, These men have jobs and love kids. That's nice, she thinks, but I want more. So she continues upward to the third floor, where the sign reads, These men have jobs, love kids, and are extremely good looking. Wow, she thinks, but feels compelled to keep going. She goes to the fourth floor, and the sign reads, These men have jobs, love kids, are drop-dead gorgeous, and will help with housework. Oh my gosh, she exclaims, I can't hardly stand it. Still, she has to see what's on the fifth floor. This sign reads, These men have jobs, love kids, are drop-dead gorgeous, help with housework, and have a strong romantic streak. She is so tempted to stay, but she goes to the sixth floor where the sign reads, "You are a visitor 31,456,000,000,000 to this floor. There are no men on this floor. This floor exists solely as proof that women are impossible to please." Thank you for shopping at the husband's store. That's a good one. I love that. Lawyers should never ask a Southern grandma a question if they are not prepared for the answer. In a trial, a Southern small-town prosecuting attorney called his first witness, a grandmotherly elderly woman, to the stand. He approached her and asked, "Mrs. Jones, do you know me?" She responded, "Why, yes, I do know you, Mr. Williams. I've known you since you were a young boy. And frankly, you've been a big disappointment to me. You lie, you cheat on your wife, and you manipulate people and talk about them behind their backs. You think you're a big shot when you haven't the brains to realize you never will amount to anything more than a two-bit paper pusher. Yes, I know." The lawyer was stunned. Not knowing what else to do, he pointed across the room and asked, "Mrs. Jones, do you know the defense attorney?" She replied again, "Why, yes, I do. I've known Mr. Bradley since he was a youngster as well. He is lazy, bigoted, and he has a drinking problem. He can't build a normal relationship with anyone, and his law practice is one of the worst in the entire state. Not to mention, he cheated on his wife with three different women, and one of them was your wife. Yes, I know him." The defense attorney almost died. The judge asked both lawyers to approach the bench and in a very quiet voice said, "If either of you idiots asks her if she knows me, I'll send you to the electric chair." Those are awesome. Oh, that's killer. All right. Now, it is time to worship. And we are going to sing Only Jesus with you two.
Make it count, leave a mark, build a name for yourself. Dream your dreams, change your heart above all else. Make a name the world remembers. But all an empty world can sell his empty dreams. I got lost in the light, and it was up to me to make a name the world remembers. Jesus is the only name to remember. And I
great song. All right. Now, shout to the Lord.
Among us who have people in our lives that are like that. I too spent time with a friend of mine last weekend who he's become very philosophical and he's become very conscious of his relationship with God. And I am very impressed by that. And after knowing this person for so long, I'd have to say whatever illness he's got is a miracle. And I'm sorry that it sounds bad, but for him to get that close to his Creator, if that's what it takes, then by God, you know, I'm going to be right there to the end. So we want the carriers on here. Scott, right?
Yeah.
Okay, Scott, we're praying for Scott. Scott's having some issues. This was a previously unspoken request. We're not going to give you any details, but we are going to tell you his name. And we want to pray for Scott. Go ahead, sweetie. Oh, yes, Uncle Dave is having some trouble right now. He's not well. So, and we love that guy. He's awesome. I love that guy. So we want to pray for Dave. He did? Oh, that's what is going on with it? I didn't know. Well, we're just going to pray for Dave. explains the look on his face. You don't function too good without her, do you? No, we wouldn't hear without her either. We love Shelly. As far as I'm concerned, Shelly's one of those miracle people that we got to our church. And I love her so much. Harold and Shelly are two very special people. And I mean, just how I met them and how they came, it's awesome. Go ahead, DJ.
For you to stop smoking.
Don't you love kids? I have to do this now, don't I?
They speak the truth.
Boy, lunch is going to be a challenge. Go ahead, sweetie.
My friend Rose and her stepfather Clark and their whole family.
Rose, Clark, and family. Sandy?
My friend Jill's dad was put on hospice.
What's his relationship with God? No clue. I bet he's thinking about it. I bet he is. I hope he is. Go ahead.
I have a praise. I had my eye surgery on the left eye Tuesday, and it's terrific. It turned out real successful. Now I'll get my right eye done, and it might not need the cataracts taken out then.
Well, your eyes work. That's awesome.
I can finally spread a little needle.
You know, she told me this morning, again, she does this every now and then, that I'm very handsome. So clearly it's working.
She's still me.
No, none of y'all say that. Y'all fine. No, I thought that was cute. So anyways, anybody else? Go ahead.
I just had a text. My dad is having, he had a rough night. All of the same symptoms.
Okay, we'll pray for Jesus' dad. Who's next? All right. Go ahead.
We have a praise for the little boy that was hit on Sheridan.
Oh, I heard about that. Yeah,
he returned back to school this past week.
Nice. What was his name?
Jason Otsuma.
Jason. Yeah, I heard that was a little traumatic. That's a bummer. I mean, you just standing right there? What happened? Ah. All right. We're going to pray for you too. All right. Oh, I'm sorry.
Can we just pray for all the new people that keep coming to church?
That's awesome. And I wasn't even here. Maybe that's what we need, is I'll just take off for a couple of weeks and then you guys can fill the place up. I'm not shaving again, just so you know. Yeah, absolutely. Praise for our congregation. Absolutely. Absolutely. Next week ought to be really fun. Let's see what we can do. We're going to have to make another deal for another time, that if you fill the place, we'll do something else. Maybe we'll throw a pie in Pastor Bush's face. I love that one. All right, let's go to prayer. All right, Lord Jesus, you have blessed us with a beautiful day outside. You blessed us with this family that only you could have assembled. While Lord, we don't know each other terribly well, we share some of the same burdens. We have some of the same sins in our life, and we have the same God. And friends are friends forever if the Lord's the Lord of them. And so, Lord, today we praise you for this building. We thank you for this place to congregate and for every single person that is in this room right now. We lift up to you, Lord, these folks, for Gina's dad, that you would comfort him and stay close to him. Lord, for the carriers as they deal with this, the end that's coming, the one that's coming for us all. May you prepare their hearts, Lord, and that you comfort them and lift them up as well. We pray for Scott and ask that you would be with him, that you would bless him, and that you would help him see you in whatever's going on in his life. Lord, we miss Dave. Lord, you know what's going on with him, and I pray that you would heal him quickly, that he would be up and around, and we would see him again very, very soon. We thank you, Lord, for Shelly, and praise you for bringing her to this family. We love her very much, and ask that you would just wrap your arms around her for all of us. For Rose, Lord, and her family, and Clark, Lord, just lift them up. Whatever's going on in their lives that needs your attention, or if they need to your attention, just be with them. For Jill's dad, again, Lord, we see that when the end comes, we have an opportunity. And I pray that this is a chance for him to get close to you, if he's not, or to help spread the love and show what real, true meaning of no fear in you means. We thank you, Lord, for Elaine, and that she can see well. And I hope that you would continue to heal her, that her next surgery is the same. And Lord, we lift up Jason. We pray that whatever's going on in that life, that you would be a part of it. Lord, many of us here have these addictions. I cannot speak for those around me, but I know what it means to be challenged, to stop doing those things that we know are wrong, and yet we continue. So Lord, I pray that for all of us and for myself, that you would strengthen us in this way, and that we would find a new passion for other things that could potentially take the place of all of these. Lord, give us strength. Help us to see clearly your will, and that we would act upon that, and not just what we think is right. So we give this family, Lord, and this day to you, and ask that you would bless us all, that we would not leave the same as we walked in. In your name, Lord. Amen. All right. While we're young.
What?
Aiden, for you. You're next.
From the Word of God is from 1 Corinthians 2, and Paul is speaking. And so it was with me, brothers and sisters. When I came to you, I did not come with eloquence or human wisdom, as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God. For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I came to you in weakness, with great fear and trembling. My message and my preaching were not with wise and persuasive words, but with a demonstration of the Spirit's power, so that your faith might not rest on human wisdom, but on God's power. We do, however, speak a message of wisdom among the mature, but not the wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age, who are coming to nothing. No, we declare God's wisdom, a mystery that has been hidden, and that God destined for our glory before time began. None of the rulers of this age understood it, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. However, as it is written, what no eye hath seen, what no ear hath heard, and what no human mind has conceived, the things God has prepared for those who love him. These are the things God has revealed to us by his Spirit. The Spirit searches all things, even the deep things of God.
All right, one more time, I believe. Yes. It is time to sing once more. Please stand and sing Jesus Saves.
Thank you. wondering how many people have heard that song you just sang before? How many have never heard it before? That is one of the oldest songs, and it is special to me because it was used in a street meeting that I was at when I was a kid, and they sang that, Jesus Saves, and if He saved, I recognized I needed to be saved. So that's a special song for me. It's one we hardly ever sing anymore. It was great in the revivals of the 40s and 50s when Tabernacles, how many of you know that Muskegon used to have a tabernacle downtown? And every Sunday night, the place was usually packed. And one of the songs that they almost always sang was Jesus Saves, Jesus Saves. So just a bit of history. Okay, Tim, what you doing with my clicker?
You don't need it. Before you have time in.
There we go. 1 Corinthians, we're going through one of the books, one of the New Testament books that the Apostle Paul wrote, and he wrote 14 of them. I believe I'm one of those who believes he also wrote the book of Hebrews. Some don't, so that gives him 14 books of the New Testament the Apostle Paul wrote. And one of them, he wrote to 1 Corinthians and another letter after this even. But you have to understand what Corinth is. If you look at the extreme, as you look at the screen down lower right hand, it's off the screen would be Jerusalem. And if you draw a line up diagonally, you'll come to Corinth on the other side of kind of the bay that's there. It's a seaport city. And it is a metropolitan city. And you can see that just very quickly, because there's a lot to get to today, very quickly, that Corinth was very much like our city of Muskegon. We are a port city. Not as probably as big as Corinth. It grew to be a very large, large city. And a lot of people there. But when we get to Corinth, you see how far the gospel had spread. If you look at the legend on the map, it's probably about 600 miles from Jerusalem up to Corinth, and longer if you walk it and don't use the boats, it would take you a long time to get there. The reason I bring it up is because Corinth was a place that on the day of Pentecost in Jerusalem, which was 50 days after the Passover, 50 days after Jesus rose from the dead on Holy Week and Easter. The people who had come to Jerusalem for this great celebration, today is Super Sunday, Super Bowl Sunday. They say that over 19 million people will watch that stupid game this afternoon. And I probably will be one of them. So. But there will be in the stadium close to 100,000 people. Jerusalem, everybody went to Jerusalem for Passover. And Jesus had died on what we call Good Friday, resurrected on Easter Sunday, and 50 days after that, the festival, the party is over, and the people that had been saved at Jerusalem began to go home. They didn't have airplanes, so they walked. It took a long time. And over in Corinth, there was a lady by the name of Lydia. And she was a Christian. But she didn't have a church. There were no churches. So the Apostle Paul said, oh, and he began to travel, and he went to Ephesus, and he went to all the other churches. And he finally landed at Corinth, and he built a church. Not him, but the Holy Spirit. So that church was living in a corrupt city, a religious city. Venus was their god. The other day, I didn't realize this, but I was in a home, and, well, I realized I was in a home, but there was a magazine, and it's a women's magazine, and it had Venus on it. I think they make women's lingerie or something, and I just, is that true?
Crazy.
What?
Crazy.
leg raisers, they do that too? Okay, I didn't know that, but it's more information I needed. But anyway, I looked at that and I thought, in light of that, Venus is the goddess of love. Isn't it interesting that everywhere you look, people want to be loved? And they want to love. And it's interesting, as far back as history as we know, they even had a goddess. Now, it was a wicked religion. The men that were part of that false and evil religion were expected to worship, and how they worshiped was very immoral, very ungodly, because they were expected to come and perform acts of sex with courtesans. That's a highfalutin name for prostitutes. And the men then that enjoyed them would have to keep replenishing the supply of pretty women, and many would send away to foreign countries to bring beautiful women in. That's the kind of religion there was today. It reminds me of America today. We don't have those churches that are dedicated to that sort of thing, but the thing that it shows us is that everybody wants to be loved. And they want to express love. Many don't understand what love is, and they didn't either. The city was complex. It's noted for its athletics. The first Olympiad was held there. It was artistic, and it was rich. They were rich because they had the seaport. All of the commerce went through the seaports, and they made a lot of money. So it was very, very similar to the world we live in. And the reason that Paul wrote the letter is because, first of all, he got there and the church was established. Paul was the pastor there about 18 months, a year and a half, and then he left. And while he was gone, after he had gone, someone in the church sent him a letter because they were having some problems in the church. Every church has problems. That's because we're people. And they had some problems, and they wrote him a letter. But even before he got the letter, that 1 Corinthians was written to respond to the issues that they were facing. But in 1 Corinthians 1, verse 11, it told us that Chloe said to Paul, "We got some problems, and you need to fix them right now." So we have a letter that is an official letter from the church asking for help. Probably what he had left there, probably it was not necessarily authored by, but brought to the attention of their current pastor, which was Timothy. Timothy was a real young man when he started pastoring, probably 20, 22, 23 years old in that neighborhood. And he was having to, I can remember being a young pastor looking out at older people, more mature people. Now I do the same thing, only I'm one of them. And Timothy didn't know what to do. So he wrote a letter, had a letter written. But before he even got the letter, Chloe said, "Hey, we got some problems." And the problem was there were divisions. But he founded that church, and last week we talked about how Paul preached. He got discouraged, he was encouraged, and then he pastored there, and we go all through that. That's where we were last week. But how did he preach? Okay. What did Paul preach? And that was the scripture today. Paul said, "I didn't come to you with intellect and great big words, theological words." He could have. Paul was very educated. But he preached Jesus. That's one of the themes why last Sunday and again this week and again next week you will have that same YouTube video, which is Jesus. I don't want to build a legacy. It's only Jesus. That's what he preached. That was his message. But to whom did he preach? Well, that gets us to our text in chapter 2. We come to this wonderful text and we find that the Apostle Paul was having trouble being understood. And people would say to him, "What did you mean by that?" And they were saying, I don't understand the prophecies. And Paul, you're just too deep. Your sermons go right over our heads. We're not... And they began to look at him, and they would say something like this, well, I just don't understand how God could do stuff. I just don't understand the deep things. Now, there's a problem with that. Because a deep thing to one Christian, who maybe perhaps is a little longer in his faith, would say, well, that's not deep. That's one of those essentials. And what's deep to one Christian is not deep to another, and they had all kinds of problems. And Paul wrote, and when he said, we read it just a little while ago, none of the rulers of this age understood the word of God, for if they had, they wouldn't have crucified the Lord of glory. However it is written, now look at this. Many Christians start off strong, and they read the Bible. And they get to some difficult passages, or they get to some passages, and they say, I just don't understand that. How can that be true? I just don't understand it. Paul wrote, no eye has seen, nor ear has heard, nor mind conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. And people stop there with that verse. It's a shame. Say, I can't understand the Bible. The prophet Isaiah had the same problem. He wrote that in Isaiah 55. He wrote and said, my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. And my thoughts are beyond your description. And many people feel that way. Christians read the Bible and they get up, but then they don't read verse 10. But God has revealed this to us by his Spirit. There is nothing unavailable to a believer as he reads the Bible. God hath revealed the things that are higher. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. God has revealed the secret things that some people say, well, I can't understand that, so I can't. Well, and they quit reading. So I gotta move on. So Paul began to identify the people to whom he's writing. And he starts it in verse 10, where he says, the Spirit searcheth all things, even the deep things of God. That's the spiritual man. God wants to reveal his will to you. And here's the great truth is this. That what is deep to you may be shallow to another. Because God deals with us individually where we are. And so as we grow, those that are in the shallow waters, and it's I got the basic rudiments of faith. In fact, he even wrote in the book of Hebrews, he said, he told them that I couldn't talk to you as spiritual men, but I had to talk to you as babies, infants, and you desire the sincere milk of the word, just the gospel. Who knows what the gospel is? Somebody give me a real quick answer to what the gospel is. Good news. Okay, that's good. Jesus died, was buried, he rose again, and he's coming again. And if you believe that, you just got a big suck of milk. That's wonderful. You can understand that. You can understand the fact that Jesus had to die because the wages of sin is death. And, oh boy, I sin. I'm going to die. But I don't want to die. I want to grow and I want to live. Well, you have to get more than milk. The spiritual man, look what he says. For who knows the thoughts of a man except the man's spirit within him? In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. We have not received the spirit of this world, but the Spirit who is from God, that we may understand what God has freely given us. We just finished that series on what's next. And by the way, those of you that have asked for the notes, they are out on the table if you want them from that series. So feel free. But people have read the book of Revelation till they're blue in the face and say, I just don't understand it. Hopefully you were able to garner something from what we got. Attempted to make it so we could understand it. That might take you to your knee. But if you're still back here with the gospel, you're not going to understand, why did God have to judge? Why do we have a 70th week? Why do we have Israel and all these other stuff? God takes you from where you are to where he wants you to be, one step at a time. One step at a time. And so he comes here, and the first kind of man that Paul spoke to was the spiritual man, expressing the spiritual truth in spiritual words. Oh, okay. You say, well, I go to church, and you church people have your own language. We talk about justification, sanctification, reconciliation. Oh my goodness, what do all those words mean? And the Spirit of God will begin to apply them to your hearts. And so we have our own language, and they come in here and whoa, it's so confusing to me. Yeah, probably would be. But you know, every place you go, you have your own language. A mechanic fixing a car can name pieces and parts of your cars you didn't even know it had. And it's all Greek to you. You just don't understand it. One of the biggest things when we started ministry at a racetrack, oh my Lord, what's tight? What's loose?
What?
What are marbles? What's stagger? We all know that. Upper and lower and all of those, they have their own language. And usually it's Southern, with a Southern drawl, because that's where it started. You go to a dye shop. Tim works in a dye shop. He talks about stuff, and they're dealing in thousands, millions. He talks a language when he's talking about work I don't know anything about. Every place you go, your work, you have your own language. Today's Super Bowl, quarterbacks. Everybody talks about quarterbacks, and every team that they go to has their own jargon. I know what a route tree is. How many know what a route tree is on a football field? Well, see, they got their own language. All of the receivers, there's six possible receivers at any given time on the field. And when the quarterback calls a play, he gives them a route tree. This guy's going to go straight to the post. This guy's going to go to the flag. This guy's do a crossing route. And they all have their own lane. Every place you go, you have the same thing. Why would it be different in our church or our Christian life? We have to learn the culture. We have to learn the language. We have to learn what God wants. But the second guy that Paul spoke to, because in every church we have these people, there's the stupid. Now that's crude. The stupid. The man without the Spirit of God does not accept the things from the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he can't understand them. He can't understand them because he is blinded, or in the NIV says discerned. Why can't he understand the things of God? Because he doesn't know God. He's stupid. I'm sorry. We have hundreds and thousands and millions of people who are educated so far beyond their intelligence, it's incredible. can't know the things of God because they don't have the Spirit of God. And how do you get the Spirit of God? By understanding the milk, the gospel. I'm a sinner. I'm going to die. Jesus died so I wouldn't have to. Because he rose from the grave, I live. That's it. And people can't accept that. And he told them, he said, these people, they think that's just foolish. Certainly I'm a good person. Don't you all feel like you're pretty good people? Y'all come to church, don't beat your wives. Hope not. I don't, because I'm afraid of her. But you don't beat your wife, you go to work, don't steal, don't abuse children, and I give. There are many times people come to get married, and one of the things I always try to encourage them to do, first of all, that I would like that they both know the Lord as their Savior, and if they don't, one does and one doesn't, I won't marry them, but if they're both saved or unsaved, it doesn't make any difference, no matter what they are, I tell them, you got to learn to give. Got to learn to give. What do you mean? Because that's just good business. Investments. It's just good business. I say, if you don't want to give to church, nobody here, I won't say that to you guys. If you don't want to give to church, give to United Way. Give to Warriors, the Wounded Warriors. Give to something. And they look at you like, why? It's because they don't understand. How do we get to understand and be that spiritual guy is when you trusted Christ, the gospel, and asked Jesus to save you from your sins because he's the only one who can, you were indwelt with the Spirit. In fact, later in this epistle, he says, don't you know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? Now, doesn't that sound stupid? If you weren't a church person, and somebody says, oh, God lives in me. Oh, yeah, right. You see, this guy who doesn't receive Jesus, he is stupid, and he's blind because he can't know. Thank God for his Holy Spirit who convicts us of our sin and draws us unto righteousness. But who's this third guy? There's the spiritual. That's those of us who are seeking to grow. And we will grow at a different rate, each one of us. Because we're not dealing with the same things. I'm not dealing, well, kind of am, but I'm not dealing and watching a loved one slowly, 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 painfully drift away. I'm not dealing with that. So the growth in a situation like that, I'm not dealing with, as a pastor, with unemployment. Oh, believe me, we don't pass the plate, but you pass the plate when you walk around up here. Drop something in. Because, yeah, you see how different my relationship to the giving of a church than yours is. Or the mission, the ladies, next week we'll have Muskegon Pregnancy Service here, and the ladies that they're dealing with whether or not to abort, whether or not I should adopt the child out. It's a totally different place where each of us are. And so God deals with us differently and at different rates of speed. So we get to this guy down here, brothers, in chapter 3, verse 1, he says this, brothers, I could not address you as spiritual. Oh, you mean I can be in church and I can be the temple of the Holy Spirit and not be spiritual? Ah, yeah, you can. He says, I can't address you as spiritual but I have to talk to you as carnal or worldly. We hardly ever use that word anymore. Back in my day when I'd go to church, I'd hear my mother or my father or the church people talking about, oh, he's worldly. Well, I can remember that. One of the things that made a woman whirly was to have nylon socks with a seam up the back. I always wondered how'd my dad know that that was worldly, because those were the women of the world. All that lady wears eye makeup and lipstick and rouge. They're worldly. Remember that? Come on, please, somebody. I'm not that old.
Yeah.
Travis is, though, so he understands. Worldly. It is so important for us to understand where we are. But he says, you're worldly. You're just infants. You still, he says, I gave you milk, not solid food, for you weren't ready for it yet. Indeed, you're still not ready. What would make you worldly or carnal, as it says in the King James? What would make that? I have the Spirit within me. But doesn't it say in Ephesians 5, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Be filled. The word filled is controlled. When somebody gets drunk, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, what happens to them? They lose control. Inhibitions are gone. And they do things they would never do if they were sober. The same with drug use or whatever. Don't be controlled by wine, but be controlled by the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. So how does this being filled with the Spirit? Well, if we're filled with the Spirit, we are going from the gospel, the milk of the word, the infant's drink, and we're growing as the Spirit of God teaches us. Well, the Bible talks about something that happens. He tells us in one place, do not grieve the Spirit of God. Don't grieve the Spirit. If we're grieving the Spirit, we have become carnal or worldly or fleshly. We are then controlled by the flesh and the impulses. Well, how do you grieve the Spirit? You do something he told you not to do. Oh. You do something he told you not to do. And we grieve the Spirit when we sin. What does that do? We have admitted to God and before mankind that we are being controlled by the flesh or the world. And it stops growth. When God points out to you from his word, and it's the only place. Folks, I am not your Holy Spirit. It's not my job to stand up here and point out the sins of anybody or everybody. Boy, I could. It's not my job. It's the Spirit of God's job to change lives. And he will lead you and guide you into all truth. Where it says, this, who knows the things of God? That's up the Spirit of God. Now, how does he tell you not to do stuff? Oh, he doesn't come out and tell you. He sets principles in his words. We have the Ten Commandments, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not lie. Well, that's false witness. Commit adultery. All those things. We have the negatives. We're not supposed to do that. But you know and I know life is more than black and white. There's a lot of gray. And that's where the Spirit leads. Turn to the bright light. Get out of the gray. He also tells us, don't quench the Spirit. Well, how do you quench the Spirit? We know we grieve him if we violate something he told us to do. But what about if we don't do what he told us to do? Then we quench him. And where do we fit in these three men here? Well, we probably would be unspiritual. Because once you've been born into the family of God, the gospel, anybody here ever been returned to your mother's womb and try again? All are some we thought about putting back, but...
They try.
No. The point is this. Once you have the Spirit, you cannot become the stupid. But you can become the unspiritual. And that's who this book is for. He wants to take the church at Corinth, who's already got trouble. In the very first chapter, he said there were divisions among them. How do we know they got trouble? Because there's divisions. They're divided. I like Paul. I don't like Apollos. I like Cephas. I like Peter. I like John. I really like John. He's a lover. You'd think that... And I think John had a huge following. He wrote 5 books of the New Testament. Folks, this little series here, this little part of this church, he says, brothers, I couldn't address you as spiritual, but as worldly, just mere infants, because, first of all, they were either grieving the Spirit or they were quenching the Spirit. And you're not filled, you're not controlled. And he says, here's how I know, because there's jealousy and quarreling. Aren't you acting just like the world that Jesus saved you from? There's a song, "We Are One in the Bonds of Christ." Unfortunately, we're not always. I am so grateful for this little body of believers. There's a unanimity of spirit and a likeness of heart that wants to teach. We don't need a legacy. We need Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. That will continue to be the central theme. And if we will listen to the Spirit, He will tell us how to please Him. And then we have to obey. If there are things in our personalities and our characters that need to be changed, be willing to change. Listen to the Word. You know, there's some things that God can't do. There is not a sin that God cannot and has not forgiven. Not one. Many of us have been affected in the last several years with suicides. Young people, older people, people taking their own life. Oh, folks, that is not the unpardonable sin. It's not the unpardonable sin. It's the result of quenching or grieving the Spirit of God. And God forgives. Father, forgive them. They don't even know what they do. God... Folks, do you understand the blessing you have if we will just listen to the Spirit of God? It's all about Jesus. It's all about Jesus. And the spiritual man is able to make judgments. He says, you are still worldly. There's jealousy, quarreling, and are you not worldly? You act like mere men. And then he says this. Jesus, how much do you love Him? Do you love Him? I have many times, I'm sure, as most husbands have, grieved our wives. Hopefully, not intentionally. And we understand that when I have grieved my wife, or quenched her spirit, I'm man enough to understand. God forgives me, but she has to too. And I have to be willing to turn to Jesus. God will bring that, and I know by the time I have said something, I shouldn't have said that. Even when I'm coming to the point of, I can't stop. can forgive it. God never met a sinner he didn't love. Never. And that means he loves you. We have to lift up Jesus. I don't want to be the stupid. I hope that you're not here this morning who have heard the gospel in several different ways this morning and have never asked Jesus to come into your life and save you. I hope there's none of you like that. Hope you're not the stupid. I would hope that you're the spiritual that would receive the word of God and apply it in my life, in your life, in my life. But unfortunately, we're people. And daily, we fall down that thing and, well, you better give me some more milk, Lord, because I'm struggling with the deep things. And he will. As you apply them to your life will grow. And he'll be able to talk to us as to the spiritual. The message is Jesus. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you that you gave us your word to identify who we are, what we are, where we are. Help us to respond to the gospel and be controlled by his spirit and your spirit. That we would be filled and grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord from the simple things to those which we deem as deep. Knowing that deep is relative to where I am in my love for you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's stand as we close with the song, Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Christ Jesus today. It's in his name we give these things.